Thank you very much for staying the whole day through until the end. I think now comes one of definitely the highlights of this whole conference. Please allow me to ask Nicolas Gisin to come to the stage, and he will give us a talk on quantum cryptography. Thank you very much, Nicolas.
Okay, so thank you, Gabby, for this nice introduction. And, well, it's a pleasure to be here. Usually I talk about quantum cryptography either to physicists or to people from my community. Here I don't recognize most of the faces, so clearly this is a different community, and I'll do my best to try to convey some intuitions and ideas and results on quantum cryptography. So there are really two parts in that, in quantum cryptography, two main parts. One is just quantum as an entropy source. And here the key word then will be quantum random number generator. And the second main application is to use quantum as a building block for cryptography, which comes under the name of quantum key distribution. So let me start with a very simple example, physics example, just of a beam splitter. So you have a string of photons arriving on a beam splitter, and some get reflected and go to this detector, some go straight and get to this detector. And then one detector, you label it 0, the other one, you label it 1, and in this way you get a string of random bits. Or more formally, maybe I should say, can also say that these single photons get turned by this beam splitter into an entanglement between this optical mode and that optical mode, and the two detectors then perform a measurement on this entangled state. But it's probably easier to just think that the beam splitter reflects half of a photon and half gets through. And so this is a conceptual, very simple entropy source, and only quantum physics actually offers fundamental randomness. So this is really fundamentally random. And it's also very easy to pinpoint down the origin of randomness. You can really see this is the place where it happens. It's nothing to do with complexity here. And it is also a practical random number generator. So here you have an example of such a quantum random number generator that exploits this quantum randomness. So inside that, you have actually this thing here with some electronics to also get balanced bits out of that, random bits. And actually the optical part is this cubic centimeter stuff here, which is shown larger here. And it's actually the same as technologies, very well known and mastered technologies. And there are thousands of such devices around the world. Okay, now, why are we, the physicists, so much convinced that this is indeed truly random? What allows us to be so convinced? And the reason is that actually the same hardware, so same kind of photon source, the same kind of detector, same kind of beam splitters, can actually be used to play some non-local games. So instead of having only one, you take two, can put them far apart, in principle. Now you need one thing more in order to play these non-local games. Namely, you should be able to decide what to measure here. So we'll have inputs. So the inputs, for instance, the beam splitter, which is here in, we're going to use two of these beam splitters and make an interferometer, and you can change the phase of this interferometer with these inputs. But essentially, it's the same hardware that you have, and then you get random results. So A, let's say, on Alice, and B on Bob's side. And if you repeat that, so you choose the inputs freely, X and Y, and you collect the results, you can then estimate this conditional probability distribution of getting results A and B given the inputs X and Y. And I can now draw that in case where the inputs are binary, so just the 0 and 1, and the outputs will also be binary. So I can draw a little table here. So for instance, in this corner here, I would have the results corresponding to the input x equals 0, y equals 0, and I have four numbers, the four probabilities corresponding to the four possible results A, B. And then the same here for x equals 1, y equals 0, and so on. Okay, so that's just very simple. And Now let's suppose that we have a promise in this non-local game. The promise is that A plus B is equal to X times Y. Well, equality or the addition here is modulo 2. Okay, and X times Y, well, is mostly 0 except if X and Y are both equal to 1. Very simple arithmetic. Now, according to quantum mechanics, you cannot exactly get that. But let me assume this because it makes all the argument extremely simple. And you can actually extend then the argument with some more, a little bit more of mathematics to the quantum case. But if we have this promise, then, for instance, if you think at this corner again, where clearly X times Y, it's 0 times 0, it's equal to 0, so it means that the result 0, 1, because 0 plus 1 and 1 plus 0 are excluded. So you get these 0 probabilities here. And the same here, and the same here. Here on the other side, for the last corner, you have 1 times 1, which is equal to 1, obviously. So here it is the diagonal, which are excluded, or which come with probability 0. So this is the first thing, this promise. Now there is a second ingredient in the argument, which is called no signaling, or no communication at a distance. It just means that since there is nothing going from Alice to Bob, or going from Bob to Alice, they cannot communicate. You cannot communicate if nothing goes from the source, from the emitter, to the receiver. Now that has the following implication. If I now just use the letter P to denote this probability, so this is just a number between 0 and 1, and I look at the marginal on Bob's side in case he has chosen y equals 0, so this is just this sum here, P plus 0, it has to be the same as here, because it cannot, the statistics here cannot depend on what Alice has chosen. If it would depend on what Alice has chosen, there would be signaling. There would be communication without any physical support to this communication. So this sum here has also to be equal to P. So it has to be P here. Now, same argument with this column. Now, it's signaling from, there's no signaling in the other direction. So P plus 0 has again to be equal to this sum here. So it's again a P. Now, from here to here, there's again a P here. Now, here to here, there's again a P here. Now here, by normalization, this 2p must be equal to 1. And 2p equal 1, sorry for the elementary mathematics, implies that p is equal to 1/2. And so here you have a proof that with these very simple assumptions, you get actually perfect randomness here out in all these cases. And here you get perfect anticorrelation, but anticorrelation can be turned, of course, into correlation. So that's why actually physicists are so much convinced that they have indeed a random process with this very simple beam splitter. Now here, let me also argue a bit on what is actually a random sequence of bits. I mean, I'm a bit afraid of doing that in front of this audience, since probably most of you know that kind of things much better than I do. But you know that, so the intuitive definition is a sequence of numbers which are unpredictable. And then you define unpredictable by this Kolmogorov complexity. So it's a sequence for which a definition shorter than itself does not exist. OK, but now if you have only a finite sequence, like these many zeros, it could be random. It is possible that this comes out, that this is part of a random sequence, actually. Actually, it has to be part of any random sequence, whatever n is, but for a fixed n. OK, so we have this problem of defining finite random sequences. Now, and this is impossible to prove randomness. This is one of the difficulties. If you have a random number generator, how do you know it's really random? You always have only finite statistics because we have a finite lifetime, and so on. And here, we, with this random quantum randomness, we approach the problem a bit differently. What we do is to prove the existence of a random process, or this probability 1/2, which I just derived previously. And then we use a standard theorem that states that a random process produces with unit probability a sequence of maximal Kolmogorov complexity. So once you have a random process, based, for instance, on quantum physics, then you have a source which is going with probability 1 to produce, indeed, a random sequence of bits. Okay, and I don't need to emphasize this part here. I mean, you probably all know much better than myself that having good randomness, whether it is now for classical cryptography or for many other kind of applications, but in cryptography especially, is extremely important. If your randomness is bad at the beginning, all your system, whatever sophisticated system you have, is going to fail. And so it is really an advantage of these quantum entropy sources that we really have a random process that produces truly random sequences. Again, it's a simple process that can be modeled, which implies that the influence of the environment can be ruled out. And we can have, and it's actually implemented, live monitoring of the elementary components. We also have speed. I think I didn't mention it, but so this simple cubic centimeter produces 4 megabits per second of randomness, of quantum bit. In terms of certification, already years ago, this was certified by the Swiss Federal Office of Metrology, and very recently the French government, or more precisely the Agence Nationale de la Sécurité, so French Army essentially, gave also the highest possible certification to this physical, of course, non-deterministic random number generator. Okay, you may also say that 1 cubic centimeter is still large. One can actually go to much smaller quantum random number generator. For instance, here we studied the case where you have just the illumination, not of two detectors, but an array, two-dimensional array of detectors. And where do you have that? Well, you have that in your cell phone, mobile phone. So every cell phone has that, and the quality of these cell phones is already sufficient to actually turn them into a quantum random number generator, which really proves also shows the potential for making all that much smaller, compact, robust, and handheld, and so on. And you find that, okay, this was published, I think, last month, probably. Okay, so that's for the first part. Now let me come to the second part, quantum key distribution. So the fact is that quantum offers much more than mere randomness. There's a fact that non-local distributed randomness, or the fact is that a random event, or a quantum random event, can manifest itself at more than one location. So if you think of that intuitively, it's impossible. How could a random event manifest itself at several locations, let's say separated by 100 miles or 100 kilometers, whatever? So it looks like magic, but it is actually very well understood and mastered physics, so both mathematically mastered and also technologically mastered physics. And somehow it would be absurd that this gift of nature is not exploited. So how does it go? Well, remember that. And actually here, again, if we look at this corner, let's say in the case where x times y is equal to 0, we get this perfect correlation of the outputs. They are random but perfectly correlated. So it means the randomness that comes out here is exactly the same as here. It is perfectly random, but non-local. It comes out at two places. This is the magic of quantum, or the magic of entanglement. And you can also understand it a bit differently. Again, this no signaling. So here I wrote again this formula, A plus B equal XY. So we have our two boxes. So sometimes people draw it like one box which is elongated, but with one part which is on Ali's side, one part which is on Bob's side. Again, the inputs, the outputs on both sides, with this promise. Now let's suppose that we could clone a quantum system. If we could clone a quantum system, then obviously Bob could clone this, his part here. So he would have that. And because it is good cloning, now we would have A plus B equal XY, where Y and B are now the input and output on Bob's side. But the same relation would hold also for the clone, say C for the clone. A plus C equal XZ. Z is the input into the clone, and C is the output here. OK, so now we have V these two equations satisfied. But now let's suppose we add these two equations. And remember, if the addition is modulo 2, so a plus a is equal to 0. So the addition is simply that b plus c is equal to x times y plus z. Again, sorry for the elementary mathematics. But if we can do that, then you could actually signal. You could communicate without any physical support carrying the information. Because look, if these two, Bob and the clone, choose the inputs y and z in such a way that y plus z is equal to 1, then the sum modulo 2 of the outputs is equal to Alice's input. So these guys could know what Alice has chosen, although nothing goes from Alice to Bob. That would again be signaling. Particularly, you could communicate faster than the speed of light, but that's actually not relevant. It's just that you could communicate without anything carrying the information. If you could, for instance, communicate without anything carrying the information, well, you can stop with cryptography because then there's no way to make cryptography. As written here, so if y plus z is equal to 1, then Bob and Charlie or the clone can deduce Alice's input out of their outputs, just summing the outputs modulo 2. And so in a no-signaling world, if we assume that signaling is impossible in our world, which is a very mild assumption, which I guess everybody here believes, except those who believe in telepathy, but I hope there are not too many here, then quantum cloning is impossible. So it's another way also of looking at quantum key distribution. Since there is no cloning, if something quantum goes from Alice to Bob, there cannot be a copy somewhere else because there is this no cloning. Okay, so how does it look now more in practice? So in practice, there are many ways of doing it, but let me just show you one scheme, which is quite easy to understand, I think, intuitively. Start with a light source, a continuous light source here. Then you have an intensity modulator, which is going to cut into this continuous wave some time bins, some pulses. And some pulses will be empty, and some pulses will be non-empty. So this is exactly as you would do classical communication, at least that's the way it was done maybe one or two decades ago. You just have a train of pulses. Some are empty and some are non-empty. And then you have a detector, which is going just to measure the time of arrival. And of course, the empty pulses will not trigger the detector, and a non-empty pulse has a chance of triggering the detector. So far, this is just like classical communication. The difference is on two sides. First, there's this optical attenuator here. So we're going to attenuate the non-empty pulses. So the empty pulses are anyway empty. There's nothing to attenuate. But the non-empty pulses, you're going to attenuate them down to what we call the pseudo single photon level. So there's essentially one photon or even less than a photon on average per pulse. And because of that, quantum mechanically, these two states, the zero, so this is vacuum, and this is the highly attenuated pulse, we have a certain overlap. And this overlap, has this formula, never mind. But we have some overlap, and because we have some overlap, it is impossible to distinguish them with certainty. This is important, is to really get into this quantum regime where you have states that cannot be distinguished with certainty. That's one of the important ingredients that comes in addition to, let's say, classical communication scheme. And the other one is that, let's say with this coupler, 10% of the light, or a small fraction of the light, is going to go to this interferometer. And this interferometer has a short arm and a long arm in such a way that at this point here, two consecutive pulses are going to interfere. Now, the early one taking the long path and the later one taking the short path, they're going to interfere here. So you're going to check that the coherence between successive pulses is maintained. That's also important. Somehow you have to go to another basis, as we say in quantum physics, to make sure that indeed you are in a quantum regime and not just in a weak classical regime, weak intensity classical regime. So this is essentially one scheme, and there are more schemes than that, but this is one scheme, and you see that, so this detector is going to give you directly the data. So here you get the data very directly. And this detector is going to tell you if there is anything going wrong with the coherence. And something is going wrong with the coherence if there is, for instance, an eavesdropper who tries to play the game of, for instance, measuring the intensity of all these pulses. Okay, now more practical, it looks like that. So you will have the laser, the intensity modulator, the optical attenuator, so on. Here again you see this interferometer and all that. And then you have actually a lot of electronics, more electronics than optics in all that, because you need synchronization, you need the sifting so that you take only the data that are relevant, parameter estimation, error correction, privacy amplification, and very importantly at the end, authentication, so to make sure that Alice is indeed talking to Bob and Bob to Alice. Okay, all that can be put into a standard telecom format, this ATCA blade shown here, and it looks at the end like any standard telecom boxes that fit into the same kind of rack. If you want to go to especially long distances, and here, okay, I couldn't resist to present you some of our latest results, so this is really very, very recent here. So you need detectors which have a low dark count and still a significant efficiency. Because one of the things which is very important is that in all these boxes, you need single photon detectors. You must have detectors which are sensitive to the single photon level. And we want, of course, that these detectors are not cryogenic or things like that. Like the best detectors, they work at maybe 2 Kelvin or like that, like you have, by the way, here in the building. But this is not very practical. So we only use here a standard semiconductor in-gas detector. It's not written here, but it's in-gas detector, so it's a very standard kind of detector, the same kind of detector you also use in classical communication. You just operate them in quite a different way. And doing that, we could distribute these quantum keys, including all the post-processing, up to 300 kilometers, which is presently the world record, I believe. The purpose here was to go to very long distances, or relatively long distances. I'll come back to that. If you're on the other side, below 100 kilometers or up to 100 kilometers, you want detectors which are much faster. So you're going to use the same kind of in-gas APDs. APD stands for avalanche photodiodes. But you operate them in a different way. And here I have some results by Toshiba, which has some of the best results in a high-rate quantum key distribution. And here, for instance, you see that at 50 kilometers, we are still above 1 megabit per second of quantum keys. OK, so this slide is only there to show you that there are, of course, many, many results. And this is only a sample which I took for one of our paper, but the number of groups worldwide doing all kinds of nice work on that is very large. So the only thing you have to remember is that there are many people doing that. And there are also some of these systems, quantum key distribution systems, which are installed, for instance, between my hometown, Geneva, and Lausanne, which is about 70 kilometers away. There is a quantum channel running continuously since 3 years now, and the boxes here, okay, these are not yet the ATCA boxes, that was a larger box, but it's still a box that looks like a computer. And on top of these boxes, the smaller boxes, these are the encryptors. This only produces cryptographic keys, does all the authentication and that, but then of course these keys, you need to be able to use them, and they are used, for instance, in this case, by these encryptors, which run the standard AES protocol. So what does actually quantum key distribution achieve? So the first advantage that I see for quantum key distribution is that any attack has to be launched on the spot. You cannot wait and say, okay, maybe later I have a better technology or whatever. It's too late. If it's not done on the spot while the photon is flying from Alice to Bob, it's too late. So it is immune to any possible future progress. A second aspect of quantum key distribution is that if we only make the assumption of proper implementation, then actually for the authentication, we already need that Alice and Bob share a secret key beforehand, a short secret key with which they can authenticate their communication to do their error correction, privacy amplification, and this stuff. So from this point of view, QKD, or a better word would be key expansion or quantum key expansion. We start from a short key and we end up with a longer key. However, if we add another assumption, namely short-term security of one-way function, then cryptographic key distribution provides long-term security. This is just because the one-way function will be now used for authentication, but any attack has to be done on the spot, so the authentication must be valid and secure only for, well, the time of the quantum key distribution, so a few seconds or minutes, depending how long your key you want. And after that, even if the authentication gets broken a week later, never mind, it's too late for the adversary. So there are essentially now two ways of using quantum key distribution that I see. One is to combine it with one-time pad. Then, of course, this would be limited to the bit rate of QKD, let's say over a few tens of kilometers, presently 2 megabits per second. And that would allow information theoretical everlasting security. A second possible application is to combine it with AES, but to change the seed key very frequently, let's say every second, something like that. So if you do that and change this key every second, although we don't have a quantitative way of measuring, of quantifying security, it's quite clear that because there are only limited data during 1 second instead of, let's say, 1 week, if you change this key once a week, if you change it on every second, the amount of data available to a possible adversary is much reduced, which is going to make the life of the adversary more difficult. And secondly, also the adversary will have much less motivation, because even if he finds the key, the AES key, he would have only 1 second of data instead of 1 week of data. So motivation is also seriously reduced. Now, you all have heard of that. Vadim Makarov, hacking commercial quantum cryptography. Vadim is here in the audience, so I have to be careful what I'm saying. This is indeed an important aspect. And as you can see, this was really, including the press release, a collaboration between, at the time Vadim was in Norway, in this university, and there is Erlangen University, and there is Idikotik. And this collaboration indeed allowed one to test this quantum key distribution system. And that is indeed very important. However, this should not, one should remember that there is nothing like cracking QKD. The security of QKD is a mathematical theorem. And this mathematical theorem is correct today. And a mathematical theorem correct today will also be correct in 10 years or in 1,000 years. It's correct once forever. So the principle of QKD will never be attacked. Only the implementation may be faulty. And that's not too surprising. I mean, implementation can always be faulty, so the implementation must be checked, as is the case for all hardware and all software. So there is nothing wrong in the need of testing the hardware and the software, by the way, also, that is in these boxes, in these QKD boxes. It's not because you write quantum on it that it makes it secure. You have to test it. But the principle itself is provenly secure. By the way, for those who know about that or heard about this device-independent quantum key distribution, okay, I'm also responsible for this terminology, but I think it's not a very good terminology. And for sure, in these futuristic device-independent QKD systems, which do not exist today, but which may exist in some years, there will still be the need to check the implementation. It's not because it is written device-independent on the box that it makes it really independent of the box. So you still always will have to check the implementation. It's kind of a triviality, but I mean, some physicists at least get very confused by that part. But I hope here everybody understands that checking proper implementation is a need. Okay, something more on results here. So we have again here the quantum channel, and at the same time we have the key distillation, and we have the encrypted data. And we don't want to have three optical fibers to communicate all of that. So the natural solution is actually to use wavelength division multiplexing, which is again a very standard telecom technology. It's nothing especially quantum here. But just say that we are going to use some wavelengths for the quantum channel, some different wavelengths for the other channels, combine all that with this WDM, and then send it over a single optical fiber. Now, if you do that, one of the difficulty is that the classical channel is about a billion times more intense than the quantum. And this huge difference in intensity is a challenge, because then you have to distinguish your little photon from this huge stream of photons. And this can be done, but then there is also another problem that comes in, is that within this fiber, so this is glass, so essentially it's linear optics, but actually there's a very little bit of non-linearity in it. And because of that, something called Raman scattering means that some of these many photons will be scattered non-linearly, which changes their wavelength. And if this wavelength change happens to now fall exactly in this wavelength channel, the quantum wavelength channel, then you can no longer distinguish it. And then you get some noise, some quantum bit error rate, this one. Get the noise due to this Raman scattering. And here, so here you have a spectra. So if you shine light in an optical fiber at some wavelength, what comes out here it is per kilometer, is a spectrum which, of course, mostly sees the light that you have put in, but also sees a bit next to it. That's the Raman scattering. So when you need to put, your other channels, the quantum channel, for instance, in this minimum. And if you do that, you get these kind of results. So you can still exchange a quantum key in this way up to something like 50 kilometers. But it is somewhat limited. And here also Toshiba has some very nice results. So they had the quantum channel here, and they added 4 10 gigabit per second channels and still get secure key rates. Again, I think this is also over 50 kilometers, so it's no longer megabits, but it's more than 100 kilobits per second. And in case here they have 2 forward channels and 2 backward channels, and still get about the same key rate, again over the same kind of distance. So multiplexing classical and quantum channel over the same fibers is possible, has been demonstrated, but indeed the Raman scattering limits a bit the distance. Okay, now let's look at quantum networks. So far we were only talking about point-to-point communication. So now if you want to do that with a central bank and you have many, many subsidiaries, then eventually, very clearly, a point-to-point network becomes completely impractical because you would need, too many. So we need some other ideas. And one idea is the following, that maybe for some extremely high-sensitive data links, you still have point-to-point. But for the rest, you may have some network. And this network would use trusted nodes. So how does that work? The idea is very simple. So you do some quantum key exchange between, let's say, the Alice and some node, some secure location. And at this secure location, the data and the key, everything becomes classical. And then you just have, again, some quantum channel to the next node. Again, here, everything is classical. And again, quantum to the next node, and so on. So you jump from one location to the next, from one node to the next node in this way. And here, again, you have a picture. So in the same rack, you would have the QKD blade, and you would have this trusted node blade. Trusted node would be essentially some electronics and software. And this idea is, among other, followed by this large R&D company, Battelle, in the US, and Idécantique. And so their goal is to connect Battelle main campus in Columbus to Baltimore and to Washington. So what we have already done now since a year is a small network, this ring. Okay, then they go to this larger one, and eventually to this Columbus-Baltimore network. And their grand plan, which is still more than a dream than a plan, is to really cover North America in this way. The distance between the nodes that they envision is 100 kilometers. Now, very similar idea is also followed in Korea, obviously South Korea. So next year, we plan to install a simple link here between Seoul and Suwon, this green ring here again, then to expand it and maybe in 5 years have really the backbone, a quantum backbone in South Korea. But the most impressive plans is actually coming from China. Of course, you all know Shanghai, Beijing. Hefei is known, very well known in my community, because this is really the center for quantum optics in China. And their plan is really to have a quantum network connecting Shanghai and Beijing, again with this trusted, okay, here they call it trustable relays, but it's the same as this trusted node that I just mentioned. And so you have here really a plan for 2,000 kilometer long quantum key distribution network. Here they plan actually to have a repeater every 70 kilometers, a bit shorter than the Americans, but it's essentially the same kind of principle. And this is not a dream, this is a plan that has already the finance to do that. And it's not a cheap thing, but okay, China has greater plans than the West today. And we actually don't have only that. Their real dream is to go further. Once we have that, they want to be able to extend it to satellite, then let the satellite evolve and make a second link here. So to combine this fiber optic link between Shanghai and Beijing also with satellites and possibly cover the entire world, but let's say start with covering China. Of course, here I should say that, or here I have a slide actually on space quantum communication, and I should have added some reference also to the local Waterloo research, which is done also on this space quantum communication. But a lot is also done in Europe, in the US, and I would say also in China, and I bet that the Chinese will be the first to demonstrate such a quantum link, though I wish that Canada wins that race, but okay, let's see. Thomas is not here to contradict me. Okay. Okay, so let's come back to fibers, because that's what I know best. So how far can we really go if we don't want this trusted node? So I showed you 300 kilometers, that's a kind of world record, but 100 kilometers is what you can do now commercially, so on. So how can we really go? And the fact is that even if you use the best possible optical fibers, the best possible optical fibers today are coming from the American company Corning. We have an attenuation of 0.16 dB per kilometer. And let's suppose you use perfect noise-free detector, so 100% efficient, no noise at all, and you have an ideal 10 gigahertz single photon source. So essentially everything is perfect. Even in that very optimistic case, if you want to send one photon over 1,000 kilometers, you would have to wait centuries. So it's absolutely impossible. You will never have in optical fibers a communication over 1,000 kilometers. We can probably do a bit better than our 300 kilometers, maybe 350, or I don't know. But there will be a limit. So 1,000 kilometers is impossible. So how can we dream to go beyond that without using this trusted node? The trusted node, of course, you need to trust them. You need to secure them physically, and that's a drawback. So there is, in principle, a way. You need to entangle Alice, let's say, with some central node. And the central node, again, is entangled with Bob. And then you do something, which I'm not going to explain here, but it's, again, some quantum magic trick. You teleport that qubit, this quantum bit, to here. And once this quantum teleportation process is achieved, you have now entanglement over twice the distance. So we can play these non-local games now over twice the distance. So you have gained a factor of 2, and of course if you repeat that, then you have a factor of 4, of 8, and so on. It's also fascinating physics because these two photons are entangled, although they have never seen each other. Okay, so now if you have this idea, you can, for instance, in Switzerland, you have some fibers, let's say here, so you could say, okay, now I entangle Geneva and Lausanne. That's where we have already the commercial system. And I also have another one entangling Lausanne to Fribourg, let's say. But if I do that, to distribute the entanglement, I need to send photons. And photons tend to get lost. They don't always arrive there because fibers, optical fibers are not perfect. So there's a chance, a great chance actually, that one of the photons, maybe the one from Geneva, arrives in Lausanne a bit earlier than the one from Fribourg. And then you would have to synchronize your system, so you would have to tell your photon, the photon that arrives the first, dear photon, wait a while. But photons never wait. They travel at the speed of light continuously. So what you need to do is to put in all these places some quantum repeaters, and the quantum repeater, in addition to teleportation, they need a quantum memory. You need to be able to tell a photon here, go to my quantum memory, stay there for a while, and during this time, the quantum state of this photon is encoded in a huge entangled state of billions of atoms. And later, when I tell you, come out. So in this way, you can synchronize these quantum networks without ever going to the classical, can remain in the quantum, on the quantum level all the way through, from Shanghai to Beijing, someday maybe. Okay, so these quantum memories, they look like little crystals doped with this billion of ions, rare earth ions. Okay, and recently, for instance, we did an experiment that was actually appeared last month, really, a few weeks ago, where we teleported a photon here, so that was coding a polarization qubit, so it's a superposition between a horizontal and vertical polarized photon to this quantum memory here, or what is 25 kilometers. Okay, results look like that. Fidelity, you also heard about fidelity this morning about quantum computation, so here we are in the 80, 90%. And that's a nice demonstration. However, let's look at what is really needed for a quantum repeater and quantum memory. So that's the desired performance, and this is the state of the art. So in terms of efficiency, we would like 90%. Well, the best that has been demonstrated is close to 90%. I think that comes from Canberra in Australia. In terms of fidelity, so the quality of what comes out, we would wish 95%, and that's more or less where we are. We are a bit less demanding from the quantum computer with the 99% of this morning. We would like to have a multimode capacity. I didn't explain what it is, but anyway, this we have, has been demonstrated. Pulse duration, so even a single photon has a certain duration, a coherence time. We would like less than a nanosecond. We have 100 picosecond. It's done. Storage time, we would like a second. Actually, even 2 seconds has already been demonstrated. So it's fine. We need that it's entanglement preserving has been demonstrated. We would also wish it's simple. Well, no, this has certainly not been demonstrated. It's complicated. But there's a big catch here. And the big catch is that all these different demonstrations were using different storage medium. So some are using the crystals, which I showed. Sometimes it's just atomic vapor, not a rare earth crystal, and different protocols. So the big challenge now for quantum memories is to find one way to have all these numbers. So each number individually you can achieve, has been achieved, but no one knows exactly how to achieve everything in one system, one protocol, and one kind of medium. So that's why quantum memory and quantum repeaters still look like that. So very far from being an ATCA telecom box. But it's also good that they still work for the physicist. Okay, so I come already to my conclusion. So what I told you about is first that quantum offers truly random processes, hence truly random sequences of bits, as you have here, for instance. And quantum also offers non-local randomness, which can be used now to distribute quantum keys. Quantum networks based on trusted nodes are under advanced development in several countries, for instance, in China. Important is also to say that quantum key distribution devices exist. You can buy it. There is not a big market, but there is a market, and some have been sold, and some are running at the time we are discussing, in Switzerland, as the example I showed you, but there are also different countries where this is running presently, in small quantities. On the other side, quantum repeaters that require teleportation and quantum memory are still in the lab. And maybe just as a last slide, some advertisement, if you allow me. ID Quantique is organizing their 7th winter school on practical quantum communication. So if you want to get your hands on quantum key distribution, you can contact them. You also have some keynote speakers, and there are some discount. You can also ask for some scholarship. And if you want to know more about quantum and this quantum chance or randomness, you might find some information in this book. Okay, thank you very much for your attention.